again, Philip, for the introduction, and I'm really glad to open up the talks here at Techsylvania. And yeah, I'd like to talk about the crucial or how crucial it is for product and engineering to work together very well for the success of a company. And before I start, just a little spoiler alert for all of you that are big DC Universe, Batman, Superman fans. You might cover or close your eyes and cover your ears in the next 5 minutes or so, so you don't get the latest news on that side. So you can imagine I'm a real Batman fan, and I was really thrilled to learn that the next Superman movie will kind of most likely contain an epic fight between Batman and Superman before they actually learn to work together and achieve great things. So some of you might now ask, what the heck is that guy telling? We are not at the Comic-Con in Bucharest, but at the tech conference. And yeah, you're completely right. I'm not only thrilled because I like Batman, but I'm also thrilled because the storyline reminds me so much of how engineers and product managers work together. So let's say for the, I could go on and define the whole conversation around why is it, does it make sense to compare Superman and Batman with product managers and engineers? But I'm not going to do that. So for the sake of saving time and coming to the point, let's follow the analogy and discuss on how Superman would actually look like if you were a product manager rather than a reporter for the Daily Planet. So if Superman were a product manager, some of his characteristics would be that he has an X-ray product vision, he fights for justice as well as user experience. He can be very political, you know, when he gets to a conversation with countries. And last but not least, he's always very optimistic, or maybe a bit too optimistic, on what's possible. In the same line, let's consider Batman is an engineer, right? And that's not really far-fetched, because Batman is totally an engineer. He likes to work in the dark, he's really into tech, he likes to build his own tools, and he's has a very cynical and maybe pessimistic worldview, at least when it compares to Superman. So if you put these two characters together in the same space, on the same project, what happens is that they're normally very critical about the methods of each other and what they actually want to achieve. And that leads to the fact that they often spend a lot of their time and energy, and I mean, in their case, a lot of energy, on fighting with each other instead of joining forces and working towards the same goal, which is pretty stupid, I would say. So that being said, let's take a step back, get out of the fictional part, and getting into real world. What does that mean for Get Your Guide? 2 years ago, Get Your Guide was in a similar situation like Batman and Superman. Not that drastic, of course. We didn't get into physical fights, but our product management and engineering was really struggling to work with each other because they were so different angles, different perspectives. We didn't move fast on the product side. We already grew kind of on the business side, but everyone in the company felt that we are not moving fast enough on the product side. And influenced and inspired by books like Lean Startup or companies like Spotify, who openly talk about how they build stuff internally, we said that we need to change something. And I will take a leap forward into today and we'll tell you a little bit about how we build stuff today and what we learned during these 2 years of setting up the engineering structure as we have it right now. So if I had to condense how we work and how engineering is structured today at Get Your Guide, I came up with a single sentence. So we work in small teams that are empowered empowered by meaningful ownership and are free to experiment to achieve their goals. So that's kind of the synopsis of how we structured engineering. And what does that mean? Or there are different components to it. So how are our teams structured? And I'm very pleased that Florin kind of validated how we work. We're really strong believers in small teams. So our teams are in the size of 4 to 7 people max. And we keep them focused on a very specific part of our product. So they really own parts of the customer experience, which is in total difference from 2 years ago when we had two teams, one in Zurich and one in Berlin, which were kind of working in classic Scrum. So you would mean, okay, it's agile and everything works fine. But they were all over the place. They had a huge list of projects that they had running internally as well as externally. And as of now, today, we are really focusing each team on a single part of our user experience or of our product. And that is how we structure kind of the scope that the team works in. And we are also moved more and more towards kind of cross-functional teams. So Florian also told that this was a success factor at Bitdefender. This is also a success factor at Get Your Guide. So we bring in all the resources that are needed in order to get stuff done to move forward and improve customer experience. And that means it's not only product managers and engineers. This also includes design, marketing, or content. If that particular team has a need for it. So it's really about making the teams as independent as possible to run fast, to execute, and follow their goals. And that's being said, now we know, or I told you a little bit of how we structure the teams, but what are the goals of the teams? How do we make sure that the teams are working on the right stuff, right? And the goals, it's really important, and we had that 2 years ago. We had product managers came up with roadmaps, and it seemed to be very clear on what we were working on, but on a daily basis, somebody came in, internal and external stakeholders, to actually, I would say, sidestep our theoretical roadmap, which was so clear, and make it obsolete within 1 or 2 weeks, right? So that happened a lot. So we changed on how we set goals within the whole organization or within Get Your Guide itself, not only the engineering part, and we embraced the concept of OKRs or objective and key results, which is that the whole company is every quarter setting up goal for that quarter in order to align the company to what the company wants to achieve, what is the vision of the company. So this is very, very important that each team is setting the goals to support the overall company strategy. And by setting up goals, I'm telling not about what are the next features that we build, but rather how do we impact the customer in the next quarter. So it's basically what do we want to move forward, and this is most likely business KPIs, like for teams that work on our customer-facing website, it can be conversion. For teams that work on the customer acquisition funnel, it might be net revenue. So these are basically goals that are very concrete and tangible. So we want to improve conversion by X percent in that quarter, and the team commits to that, and that makes it very clear on how to actually measure the success of a team, but also makes it very clear to the outside of the team on what the team wants to work on. So OKRs for us are a great tool to clarify between product and engineering. So engineers are involved in that process very early on. They know what the priorities are and why we do stuff or what we are aiming for in the first place. And the big learning for us was also that, yeah, when we started that process, the objectives are mostly kind of to-do lists, right? We need to build feature X on that page and feature Y on that page. But that's totally not the goal of OKRs. It's really to make sure that we improve the business, and how we do that is kind of then up to the team, right? And another learning was that, yeah, you need to follow and check in on these goals regularly, weekly or at least monthly, in order to make sure that you still follow through and you actually in daily operations, things get oftentimes out of hand, so you're still aligned with what you want to achieve in your quarter. So I told you about the team structure, about how we set goals for the team, but the crucial point is also that we give the teams a lot of ownership. And by ownership, I mean they have decision power on what to do, right? So we don't, I now stress that again, we don't do to-do lists, we don't do big product roadmaps. Of course, we have a product vision on where to go, but the team themselves is enabled or empowered to actually drive the initiative and go or work on stuff where they believe is the most impacting to actually move the needle for our customers. So that's really important. And learnings there, this is not something that a team can come up with, because this is something that the whole company has to embrace. It's really, really important that you get buy-in from the CEO, from the management, from the founders, to actually do that and being able to do that. Because what that means is the management gives up a lot of decision power and has to trust the teams to do the right stuff, right? For inside the team, that also helps a lot in clarifying prioritization, because it's now the team, really the confined area or the small group of people that actually have a very clear view on where they move and why they do the next step. But last but not least, what do they actually do? What are teams working on? How do they decide on what to work on, given that framework that I showcase now? So the teams are, or we set up to learn about our customers, to gain knowledge that about our customer, because we have a strong belief that the only expert that we can ask on whether our product is good or it's shit is the customer in the end, right? So we're really, really focusing on getting our ideas and our hypothesis on what's good for the customer or not out to the customer very, very fast. We are doing a lot of rapid prototyping. We actually really push hard on getting the information on whether what we are building makes sense or not. And how we do that is that everything that we release basically is behind an A/B test. So we don't do any change, we don't do any new feature without testing it live to our user. And what that means is, you can think of it as we don't work on a feature for 2 months before we actually ship it, but we might work on a very, very, let's say, MVP version of that tries to validate the hypothesis that we have about the customer in 2 to 3 days, right? And then we ship that, we validate that this actually moves the needle, and if it's not, then we get back and analyze on why. Maybe we set up the test wrong, maybe we had the idea was not received very well, or maybe find out something else. So this is really the important part is about the learning. And that's very crucial. And another crucial aspect is that we've built a lot of tools around that in order to make it easy for our teams to actually do experiments. So it's very easy for each engineer to deploy the whole our whole product. Basically, we deploy on a kind of multiple times a day, and it's very easy for them to set up tests and not only build them but also follow through and actually monitor their success. So the whole analytics pipeline is also available, and that's very important to have that tool set ready in order to make them run fast, right? So they don't struggle to in the execution of the test, but they can really focus on what they actually want to test and get knowledge and learnings out of that. So main learnings here are, yeah, really many small steps are for us way more successful than big projects. So we really try to reduce and simplify our experiments as much as possible, because we learned that, let's say, the effort that it takes to implement an experiment has no correlation to the business success of that experiment. So we can either spend 1 month on a big experiment and maybe learn that it doesn't influence the customer at all, or we run a multitude of experiments that we can really push out rapidly in high frequency and learn a lot more. So that's also clarifies a lot and simplifies prioritization inside the team, because it's always kind of how much is the effort to actually implement something? What do we think we will learn from that experiment? And second learning is that the product manager is no longer defining the roadmap, but the whole team actually we extended our agile, let's say, tool sets with idea sessions, where the team is actually generating and defining new experiments on what they want to work on next, and then putting them into the backlog and prioritizing. And the role of the product manager changed in the sense that he's now more of a helper in the prioritization step, but foremost in the simplification of the experiment. So how can we make or break down the experiments in order to make sure that we get the learning out and we don't have to invest too much upfront? And regarding experimentation inside the company, it's really key to set the right expectations. So when we started, we thought each experiment has either thumbs down or thumbs up, right? So you either learn it works or it doesn't. In reality, most of the experiments are in this gray zone. We call it the shrug zone, where you don't even see any difference. So it's kind of irrelevant what you change. So it's really important to set the expectations so that the company as well as the engineers are not frustrated by the fact that they might need to push out a lot of experiments in order to find a nugget that is actually improving customer experience. So with that, I'd like to wrap up. So we've learned, or if I would say that the blueprint of how we manage our teams is kind of condensed in that single sentence, and this allows us also to grow the engineering organization very, very fast. If you see, okay, we want to focus on a certain area, new area of our product, then it's very easy to set up a very small team and make them run and do experiments and learn to see whether it works or not, and then put more resources on it if we see that that we are actually successful in that endeavor. So with that, thanks a lot for your attention. And
thank you very much.
So, can you shut up?
Yeah, okay. No, I have one too. So thanks very much for that great talk. So I'd like to take the opportunity to take also one or two questions from the audience while we're setting up the next speaker. So again, I can't see anything, but there should be somebody with a microphone in there. So if you have a question, there I see somebody raising his hand. So can the person with the microphone please go over there, and maybe if you can come out of the row to the side, there's a microphone over there. So feel free to ask your question.
I'll take that. Hi.
My question would be, first of all, big fan of your work, and I was accessing the site recently. I saw that you've kind of shifted from offering the local guides to buying tickets for different events and locations. So what made you make this shift in your business model?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
When I access your site now, I can see that you can buy tickets worldwide to different trips or different locations. And what made you make the shift in your business model from getting those local guides? What was your initial idea?
So this is more about kind of whether kind of the approach that I, sorry, to just to make sure that I understand the question, on whether that influenced on what we do on the business side or not. Is that true?
What was the reason behind this change? Was it the result of what you just said, or what was the reason behind?
No, the reason was that people got frustrated, right? And we had a lot of we lost a lot of energy in internal discussions between product and engineering on should we build or should we invest in refactoring stuff, or are the engineers not fast enough, or do we prioritize the right products or the right features? So it was really, really around that in order to make sure or to clarify and get clarity on what matters most to the customer. It was kind of really that helped us a lot in getting clarity around prioritization as well as understanding our customers much better.
Okay. Thank you.
One last question, if somebody still has. Okay. Then, in that case, there's Marius again, of course. Please, Marius, go ahead. Okay, so the question, just to repeat quickly, was how do you keep your employees engaged?
Very, very good question, and the answer is we look for engineers that are product driven, and they need to get the satisfaction out. It's really key to kind of they want to move the needle for the customers, right? It's this is really key. If you're only into tech and if you want to build the kind of work with the greatest technologies, that might not be the best place for you to work in. But if you really care, or if you really want to learn also kind of the business domain, if you really want to learn about how products work and how you can actually influence the customer, that's really great. And people are really fired up because the engineers have a lot of more to say on what to do and where to do, because normally the discussions inside the teams are not revolving around my idea is better than your ideas. Normally it's like, we disagree, but let's test it out, right? So we write an experiment to see actually whether customers like it or not, and it's not no longer an ego game whether product manager is right or the engineer is right.
Okay, that was a great sales pitch. I'm sure you have a lot of applications from the audience after that. Thank you very much, Pascal. Give him a hand.